solar radiation always through the year. The center is has around 100 hectares of land, as you see in the aerial view, and just around this part is where the facilities and the laboratory belongs to the solar treatment of water unit is located. Here you can see a view of the solar reactors that we're using for testing of the solar treatment. Also, we have a very well-equipped laboratory for the analysis of water from the point of view of the analysis of contaminants and also microorganisms. Also, a part of the solar facilities, we have a number of conventional systems for water treatment, such as UVC pilot plant that I will show you later, also ozone, nanofiltration, etc. So just now let's go to start with the real contents of the presentation, which has a short introduction about the water problems. Then we will see the microbial contamination of water, some notes about the water regulation that we have right now. Then we will see the advanced oxidation processes, and then we will focus more on the advanced oxidation processes that can be driven by solar light and other photochemical processes, and finally, some concluding remarks. Well, as all of you already know, we have an important problem with the water right now. You know that the water distribution is not homogeneous around the world, and even not all the water in the earth is available for human consumption. In particular, only 1% of the 2.5% of the fresh water that has the earth is available for human consumption. As you can see in this figure, the distribution is not homogeneous, the water is not available because most of them is in form of ice and in glacier, which is permanent and it cannot be used by other activities. Then we have a number of water, such as the groundwater, but also not homogeneously distributed, and the lowest percent is in forms of wetlands, lakes and reservoirs and rivers. But this is not the only problem with the water. If not, there is other reasons to which right now we have a scarcity. We speak today that we have a very problem with the available of water. And between these reasons, we can highlight the climate change, which obviously affect the land in terms of increasing drought season, increasing overflowing, etc., which make the water not so available. Then other important reason is the growth of population. That, as you know, the human population is increasing very high during the last especially last century. Currently, you can as you know, we are more or less 8 billion of people in the world. And for to have this the well-being of all this population regarding water, the consumption and the demand is every time increasing and increasing. And one of the not only from the point of view of the requirement of water for human consumption, speaking on drinking water, there is other activities, other anthropogenic activities that consume a lot of amount of water. And in these particular activities, agriculture is one of the most consumer activity for generating the food that that every human need for the dietary. And according to the FAO, the agriculture consume around the 17% of the total fresh water available. Also, apart of all these activities, currently the water pollution associated to the human to human activities from the point of view of domestic activities, agriculture and also industry is generating that the water the freshwater resources will be every time more and more polluted, which make these water resources not available for or safety for a safety use. The main pollutants that we can found in the water there are two main groups, which are the pathogens, but also the chemical contaminants. And normally, all these pollutants are together in the water resources that are contaminated. But in this webinar, we are focused mainly in the pathogens. But don't forget that all the contaminants are present, and all the contaminants should be eliminated if we want to have a safety water for using. So, among the microbial contamination that we can find in the water, there are divided in different type of groups of microorganisms, which are bacteria, fungi, viruses, and protozoa. The resistance of these different groups of microorganisms to being activated vary from the bacteria to protozoa, which are the most resistant type of microorganisms against the treatment that we can apply. The example in each group we have different a very wide type of species and genus. So, and here you can see only the most important and the most abundant that we can detect in different water contaminated. From the point of view of bacteria, we have the very common Escherichia coli, Enterococcus, Pseudomonas, Salmonella rubrum, and even among the fungi, we can find Fusarium, Orpidium, Aspergillus, or Candida. Between the viruses, we can find Poliovirus, Rotavirus, Norovirus, and also Bacteriophages. And among the protozoa, we can have Acanthomeba, Cryptosporidium, Entamoeba, and Giardia. But apart of, from the, this this group of contamination, recently there is another new change in when we speak about the wastewater, the management, and the treatment, which is they call antibiotic-resistant bacteria. This particular microorganisms are actually bacteria. But these bacteria have modified their internal capability to resist the presence of antibiotics. And this is the definition of the antibiotic-resistant bacteria is the phenomenon by which a microorganism is no longer affected by an antimicrobial, specifically antibiotics, at which it was previously sensitive, so that usual medical treatment become ineffective and the infections persist and can be transmitted to other people. This is actually an important challenge, not only for wastewater, but also in medicine and in clinic for treating infection. Because when we apply the typical treatment based on antibiotics for inactivate the bacteria that are generating the infection, if they are resistant, we have a problem because we cannot kill this type of microorganisms. And actually, the number of antibiotic-resistant bacteria that has appeared and spreading on the environment, reaching humans and reaching animals are increased, and this is are generating a big problem from the clinical and medicine point of view. It's so important this matter regarding the antibiotic-resistant bacteria that a few years ago, the World Health Organization published a list of priority pathogens, and here is the list in this table, based on the critical and the important impact of infection based on these microorganisms, and here you have the microorganisms and the specific antibiotic resistant. As you can see, most of them are resistant to the last and the more Recently developed antibiotics, which can cause a lot of important problems in medicine and also are generating the death of person due to this resistance. Associated the antibiotic microbial bacteria in wastewater, you can see in this figure a map with two different blue colors. The light blue is where the prediction of the spreading and appearance of new antibiotic-resistant bacteria are low in comparison with the dark blue, where is expected a higher estimation of number of ARD. And this is associated to the low or absence of a proper wastewater treatment, because wastewater the treatment plants, when we have a proper wastewater treatment plant, we have different step, and during the second step of the wastewater treatment plant is where the selective pressure for generating new antibiotic resistant bacteria has the most important focus, because you have coexisting the bacteria, the genetic material that can be regenerated by mutation and also by transfer, by vertical transfer and by horizontal transfer, this resistant, and also the presence of very small concentration of many different antibiotics. So when we have all together, this generated the enough pressure to appear new bacteria and the spreading. But if we apply a tertiary treatment, which is the tan oxidation process, is another type of treatment after the secondary process, we can reduce a lot of the spreading of these particular microorganisms in the environment before the effluent being discharged in the environment. So for this reason, the prediction of the antibiotic resistant spreading in the world is more associated to those countries or areas where have a low or absence of appropriate wastewater full treatment. Now in this slide, we can see examples of maximum detectable concentration per liter regarding the different groups of pathogens and the more important group of pathogens that we can see in polluted water. We have the groups of bacteria, which is typically highlighted by the presence of Escherichia coli or coliforms. Then we have viruses, and also we have Cryptosporidium. Viruses is the representative of the virus group, and Cryptosporidium the representative of the protozoa groups. Viruses is the first and most important group of microorganisms that generate the diarrhea or the intestinal disease in childhood. Then the second most important group is the Cryptosporidium, and then the Escherichia coli. And the concentration, depending on the water sources, but vary extremely. For example, from underground water, where we can find some contamination, but it's too low in comparison with wild rivers, contaminated rivers, lakes, and of course, is in wastewater effluents, where this concentration can be detected in high level. Regarding the presence of antibiotic-resistant bacteria in wastewater, due to this important, I have included also this information in the presentation. We can find different type of bacteria, such as E. coli, Enterococcus faecalis, Pseudomonas, Salmonella, Shigella, Klebsiella, and Acinetobacter, which are listed by the WHO, as I saw you before, and also they can acquire the antibiotic resistance. In this figure, you can see the abundance of the natural occurring E. coli and Enterococci, and also the concentration of the same bacteria that has acquired the resistance to the tetracycline and sulfonamides. in the effluents in the influent and the effluent of wastewater treatment plant. These data are general, and you can see how the concentration in the case of E. coli is higher than enterococci. This is normally, but also you can see how we have very high concentration of the same bacteria, but that has acquired this resistance. Don't forget, as I told you before, that the antibiotics as chemical contaminants are super important. And here I have put you some data regarding the occurrence of the most common antibiotic detected in the influent of wastewater treatment plant. And the concentration, you can see the most common, such as azithromycin, quinolonas, such as ciprofloxacin, sulfamethoxazole, tetracycline, trimethoprim, etc. In the effluent, the average concentration range in between 100 and 200 nanograms per liter. And also in the same focus in the wastewater treatment plant, the presence of the antibiotic resistant genes that has been detected during last year in different wastewater around the world. One of the more abundant are the PLA, SUL, TELT, and ERP, which determine the resistance to different antibiotics. Then we go to focus in water regulation. In water regulation is of course are one of the most important parts, especially for the application of new treatment and conventional treatment for making the water safety for use for both aspects, for drinking water and also for wastewater reuse. And when we go to the regulation, we have two different scenarios. One of them is how to evaluate the new potential treatment technologies, and other aspect is the limit required by this regulation to make the water safety. So let's focus first on what we have in the different regulation for drinking water regarding the new treatment technologies for drinking, as I told you. Here we can see that when we want to treat and to check and validate the efficiency of a new treatment technology, the World Health Organization established that to have a high protective level when applying a processes, we must be sure and demonstrate that the system can reduce more than 4 log of bacteria, 5 log of viruses, and more than 4 log of protozoa. The same or similar situation we can find in the new European regulation on wastewater reclamation and reuse that has been published and started for the reclamation of wastewater and its further reuse. We observe in this table that regarding the indicator microorganisms, the regulation indicate that we must to be sure that the treatment can reduce more than 5 log of E. coli, more than more than 6 log of viruses, which are where you can select different indicator microorganisms, such as total coliphate, F-specific coliphate, or somatocoliphate. And finally, you must do also to be sure that the system can reduce more than 4 log or 5 log of protozoa, which in this case, the indicator microorganisms could be Clostridium perfringens, which is spores, or spore-forming sulfate-reducing bacteria, which typically are present in the wastewater. So the things is the requirements that for to save a drinking water, a safe drinking water, and also a safe wastewater reuse. Regarding drinking water, also at the European level, there is actually discussing and preparing a new directive for application of the quality of water intended to be used for human consumption. And a part of many other different parameters that you can found in this directive regarding the microbial parameters, it say specifically that both intestinal enterococci and E. coli must be zero number per 100 milliliter. So the water intended to be used for drinking should has this quality for its use. Regarding the regulation for wastewater reclamation and reuse, it has of course lower requirements, and these requirements also vary depending on the class of quality and the end use that are going to be used. In this case, the regulation of the wastewater is just focused on the use of on agriculture, but depending on the type of crops, depending on the type of system used for irrigation, the crops, the quality could be different. The class A is the highest restricted class, and as you can see here, the number of E. coli that is permitted to this end use is below 10 number or CFU per 100 milliliter, among other quality requirements. Well, so to obtain this value established by regulation, of course, the most important is to have a good water treatment. The definition of a water treatment is that processes that makes the water more acceptable for and in use, which may be drinking, industry, medicine, or even reuse or the reclamation of wastewater. The water treatment should remove, therefore, the water contaminants, both in both cases, microbial and also chemical contaminants, or reduce their concentration. So that the water becomes fit for its desired end use. As I showed you before, depending on the end use, the requirements could be different. And it's maybe safely returning used water to the environment. Among the different water treatment that we can found currently, we have two different classes of water treatment. One of them is those that permit the physical removal of microorganisms, which means that you only separate the microorganisms and make the water clean. But this don't inactivate or kill these pathogens or these microorganisms that are pathogen. And between the physical removal treatment, we have typically coagulation and sedimentation processes, and also filtration, which are very effective, are widely used. Sometimes it could be expensive, but do not really destroy the microorganisms. And these microorganisms that are retained by the system should be then inactivated. And then we have other group of water treatment, which are those that can kill microorganisms or inactivate microorganisms. And among this treatment, we have chlorination, we have ozone, we have ultraviolet C, and also we have the advanced oxidation processes, which is the focus of the webinar today. This type of water treatments are highly efficiency for inactivation of virus, bacteria, but also for protozoa, are widely used, but it can have some drawbacks, such as the generation of some disinfection byproducts, such as trihalometan and other carcinogenic compounds that can generate it during the application of the water treatment. So let's go focus on the advanced oxidation processes. These are chemical treatment produced to remove organic contaminants, sometimes inorganic, including both microorganisms and chemical organic contaminants in water and wastewater by the generation of reaction that finally could generate the called hydroxyl radicals. This reactive oxygen species is one of the high oxidative radicals that can react in a non-selective way with organic compounds, so that it's going to degrade until certain condition. If the water treatment is enough strong, it could mineralize the organic contaminants. And also, of course, if the great chemical contaminants also could inactivate the pathogens. Between the different type of advanced oxidation processes available, we have also two groups. One of them are the non-photochemical. It means that they are not using any source of photons for the activation or generation of the hydroxyl radicals, such as the phenton or combination of ozone with hydrogen peroxide, electrochemical oxidation of aerodynamic and ultrasonic cohabitation. And then we have the advanced oxidation processes that are driven by a source of photons that can be both by lamps, as you can see here, by normally UV lamps, or by the use of solar radiation. Among the most commonly water treatment based on advanced oxidation processes driven by solar and lamps radiation, we have the combination of UVC with hydrogen peroxide, ozone with IUV, other more complex combination, use the titanium dioxide with UV, and typically from the sun, and also the photophenton. In this presentation, we are going to see some examples and procedures based on the use of lamp and solar lights for the inactivation of microorganisms. But photophenton, I have not included information in the webinar because it's the topic of the next webinar, which will be delivered by Professor José Antonio Sánchez Pérez. So first, let's go to start with the water treatment that can be applied by the use of UVC radiation for water disinfection. The UV radiation by itself, it's a process very efficient for the inactivation of microorganisms because it can absorb the radiation at 244 nanometers by the DNA molecule. When is this occur, the DNA suffers breaks in the structure, as you can see here. The nucleotides of the molecule of DNA going to generate the malformation, and the accumulation of this alteration in the structure make it, finally, that the bacteria cannot do all this normal functioning, causing an inhibition of the cell growth and also its multiplication. And under certain conditions, the microorganisms also die. But the application of the UV radiation by itself, although it's highly efficient, it has an important drawback, which is the possibility of a photoreactivation and dark repair if the radiation has not been enough to generate all this damage and totally inactivate the microorganisms. So to apply a good and efficient water treatment based on UV radiation is need the addition of chemicals to increase the capability of the processes. Also, when we use oxidative agents, we can obtain at the advanced oxidation processes where the radicals are generated. In particular, One of the main, the most used oxidative agents in combination with UVC for increased efficiency of the processes is the hydrogen peroxide. And the hydrogen peroxide, as you can see in the reaction, when in presence of the UVC, is molecularly cleaved and generating hydroxyl radicals. So the efficiency of the processes is increased. But recently, other agents has started to test to increase the efficiency of the UV light, such as the persulfate and the peroxide monosulfate, where when exposure to the UV radiation, it generates sulfate radicals, but also hydroxyl radicals. Why to use all the other type of oxidative agents? Try to increase the efficiency of the processes. And in particular, when use sulfate salts, the persulfate or peroxide monosulfate, is because the sulfate has a high oxidation potential, which can be comparable or even higher than the hydroxyl radical. The sulfate radicals react more selectively and efficiently with organic compounds, specifically with those that contain unsaturated bonds or aromatic electrons. And also, the half-life of sulfate radicals is supposed to be longer than the half-life of the hydroxyl radical. So, using these salts in the last year has been investigated at a potential higher efficient treatment for water and wastewater treatment. And recently also the use of chlorine in combination with UVC have started to be interested by researchers to increase the efficiency of the advanced oxidation processes based on ultraviolet C light. In this picture, is our UVC pilot plant at PSA facilities, which consists on a pilot plant of around 100-150 liters in total. It's a high volume of water. It consists three UVC lamps. Everyone can work independently. They are a medium pressure lamp. Sorry. So now what we are going to see some examples of the capability of this pilot plant to inactivate different type of microorganisms in water and also in wastewater. First of all, the combination of UVC with hydrogen peroxide. When we speak about the addition of chemical agents, we always speak about the addition of very low concentration. We do not consider the use of very high amount of these oxidative agents because it has not sense from the point of view of economic cost of the final treatment. So in this first figure, in the right side of the slide, we have the concentration of E. coli against the treatment time in the pilot plant that I show you now in the previous slide, and the effect of the addition of different concentration of hydrogen peroxide from very low concentration to from 5 and to 50 milligrams per liter. As you can see, how the addition of higher amount of hydrogen peroxide increase the efficiency or the inactivation profiles of the bacteria in terms of treatment time. In comparison with the inactivation, this is the profile of the effect of the only UVC over the bacteria. First of all, it's important to say that the effect of only UVC against bacteria is high efficient, as you can see, and I say also previously. So the addition of the concentration of a small concentration of hydrogen peroxide increase a little bit the efficiency of the processing against the only use of UVC. This is an example of inactivation of E. coli in simulated municipal wastewater, And now here you can see the inactivation of Pseudomonas and E. coli, but naturally occurring in wastewater in the presence of very low concentration of hydrogen peroxide, 5 milligrams per liter, and also in comparison with their antibiotic resistant bacteria at different antibiotics. As you can see here, one of the finding that we have been observed during last year regarding the application of the treatment is that there is not so much differences of resistance between natural occurring bacteria and antibiotic bacteria to atomoxidation processes. And this is a very clear results, as you can see here. The treatment time is very short, is very efficient, but there is not too much different in terms of response, the type of bacteria against the process. we continue with other examples of the application of persulfate and also peroxyconosulfate in combination with the UVC. Again, you can see how the profile of inactivation is very significantly high in the first minutes of the processes, with very low concentration in this case of persulfate against treatment time. In this case also is the inactivation of E. coli in simulated municipal wastewater. And this example is the inactivation of naturally occurring E. coli in urban wastewater with different concentration of peroxymonosulfate. So that the addition of the oxidative agents determines an enhancement of for bacterial or antibiotic resistant bacterial inactivation. But in specifically when we think on wastewater, it's important to evaluate also the degradation of the contaminants present, but also the degradation of the antibiotic resistant genes that you know now that is a very important target of degradation from wastewater to avoid the spreading of this type of bacteria. So the addition of the oxidative agents will help not only to increase the efficiency of the treatment for inactivate the bacteria, but also will enhance the degradation of the genes that could be present in the wastewater, and also the degradation of the contaminants. You can see here examples of results regarding the application of UVC with hydrogen peroxide and how different target antibiotic resistant genes will reduce a lot of the treatment time. And also in this part, we have our results where the degradation of 3-profloxacin is higher if we see and compare the results and the obtained using only UVC and using UVC with hydrogen peroxide, which is the line with the circle, with dark circle in comparison with this line. So if we focus now in the application of the atomoxidation processes for water disinfection that can be driven by natural sunlight, one of the most investigated and important treatment is the photocatalysis with titanium dioxide. The application of these processes could be done because the titanium dioxide is a semiconductor that when in water and irradiated with natural sunlight, it can absorb wavelengths below 390 nanometers would reach the air surface. This is why we can use the solar radiation for the application of photocatalysis. In this focused part of the spectrum is where you can see how the solar spectrum is over crossing with the absorption of the titanium dioxide. Other advanced oxidation processes very important for water disinfection is the photophantomass. As I told you before, I have not included here because it's going to be the focus of the next webinar. But not only advanced oxidation processes for water disinfection is important when we use solar radiation. There is other photochemical processes that could be driven by hydrogen peroxide, persulfate, peroxymonosulfate, peracetic acid, or even chlorine, which although they are not classified like a real advanced oxidation processes because the generation of hydroxyl radicals by solar wavelengths are not generated because they cannot break the chemical agents to generate this radical. From the point of view of water disinfection and bacterial inactivation, is highly efficient because there is other mechanisms of inactivation, and including the direct oxidation of these agents that could increase the efficiency of the treatment very, very, very significantly. We will see then some examples. At Plataforma Solar de Almería, the application of solar treatment with natural sunlight at pilot plant, we use the reactors called compound parabolic collectors. This system are from the optical point of view, one of the more advantageous solution for increase the photons that can be collected by the aluminium mirror that cover the photoreactors where the water flow. This is a diagram of how the solar rays that are reaching the collector area are distributed to reach the photoreactor. So the photoreactor are totally illuminated during the solar treatment, which make more efficient the use of solar photons for this type of application. We have a number of compound parabolic collectors at Plataforma Solar de Almería with different volumes. Some of them has a recirculation system, like you can see here in the diagram, and some pictures with different collector area, different tube diameters, all of them to investigate different parameters to try to look for the best operational condition and the best optimization of the different solar treatment that can be applied for water disinfection and also the contamination. And so as occurs in the case of the application of UVC, where the radiation by itself can generate damage over the bacteria or the microorganisms to inactivate. In the case of the application of solar light, the solar photons can also inactivate the microorganisms. Why? Because if you focus especially on the UV region that reach the air surface, which is the UVB and UVA fraction of the solar spectrum. UVC, of course, did not reach the surface. This wavelength can be absorbed by different chromophores and other type and other components, biological components of the cells, and finally generating by different reaction reactive oxygen species that, of course, can generate damage in the bacteria. Due to reaction with the DNA, with the other proteins, with the components of the cell membrane, that after a certain times of damage accumulation, finally will lead the cell death. Of course, this process is not so efficient like the application of UVC, so the treatment times are quite longer in comparison with application of the UVC. And also the temperature is a factor that play an important role in the solar only disinfection or solar water disinfection. And it can generate a synergistic effect to increase the inactivation of microorganisms in water. Nevertheless, this process, as I say, is not so highly efficient in comparison with the application of UVC. And for increase the efficiency of water disinfection, the application of oxidation processes by the use, for example, of the titanium dioxide or solar photocatalysis, which will increase very efficient the inactivation of microorganisms in the water. And here I include some results about the application of titanium dioxide, P25, which is one of the most important and the reference of solar photocatalysis for advanced oxidation processes. These results are related to the inactivation of Escherichia coli. This first figure is in distilled water. You can see here the log reduction value of E. coli against the accumulated solar incident per unit of area and time, and which is the parameter called QUB. This is a normalized parameter that we use to for comparison different operational conditions and different weather conditions. You see here we have the profile of inactivation by the effect of only sunlight, which is the brown line with the circle with the brown circles. It's related to the effect of solar only disinfection, and then the addition of different concentration of catalysts will decrease or increase the efficiency on the inactivation of E. coli. This can occur if we add very low concentration of catalyst. It can sometimes reduce the efficiency because these concentrations are not enough to generate good disinfection performance. Instead of sometimes it can act like a screen or for bacteria, avoiding the impact of the lights in the microorganisms. So we need to optimize the concentration of the catalyst when we want to apply this type of processes in order to have a balance between the effect of the solar radiation, because it's a baseline for the inactivation, but also a balance on the concentration that permits the generation of enough radicals to obtain a good disinfection performance. And as you can see here, only concentration higher than 100 milligrams per liter in determine a benefit, a higher inactivation kinetics in E. coli. In this case, the best concentration of titanium dioxide was obtained at 500 milligrams per liter, which should be the most common concentration for of catalyst for inactivation of bacteria. Then there is not only the concentration of the catalyst a parameter important to obtain a good performance. Optimum performance of the processes, if not also the type of water that we are testing. When we compare the inactivation of naturally occurring bacteria in urban wastewater, which is these results, you can see like the treatment time, in this case, the QUB parameter in terms of kilojoules per liter, are quite higher in comparison with distilled water. Of course, this is because the complexity of this type of waters, which contain organic matter, which contain other type of microorganisms, organic pollutants, that compete for the hydroxyl radicals generated and for the surface of the titanium dioxide. In order to increase the efficiency of the photocatalysis by titanium dioxide, researchers has also investigated the combination of titanium dioxide with hydrogen peroxide in order to improve the generation of hydroxyl radical by avoiding a recombination on the surface of the catalyst. And you can see here like a combination of the optimal concentration detected in urban wastewater, which was in that case 200 milligrams per liter, in combination with 10 or with 15 milligrams per liter of hydrogen peroxide, increase the efficiency. The full symbols, you can see how are higher than the use of the only use of titanium dioxide. Also, if the concentration of hydroxyl H2O2 is in the case of use high concentration, the inactivation could not be too much better than the use of this combination. And this is because the treatment of the or the use of hydrogen peroxide with sunlight is a very effective process, and we will see later why.
Ima,
sí,
it's three already. Just to let you know.
Okay, thank you. I will try to be faster.
Okay, no problem. Just to let you know.
Vale, okay. Thank you, Isa. So the main inactivation mechanisms by photocatalysis is due to the generation of the hydroxyl radicals on the surface of the catalyst, and also the absorption of the catalyst on the surface of the microorganisms. So these hydroxyl radicals are degrading the components of the membrane, and finally the microorganisms are inactivated. And you can see here a picture where the catalyst is absorbed on the surface of the microorganisms. So in the area of the heterogeneous photocatalysis, the researchers has also focused on trying to develop new materials based on TO2 and also other semiconductors in order to increase the capability of the semiconductors and the natural sunlight to generate more hydroxyl radical and be more effective. Then the problem is that now we have tested, especially at PSA. Here, there is some example of different system that we have tested for water disinfection in comparison with titanium dioxide. Also, any of them has been much more efficient than the titanium dioxide P25. Other area of research is the immobilization of the catalyst in different substrates and ways in order to avoid the need of retrying the catalyst after the end of the treatment, but also the scale up of the immobilization of catalyst is quite complicated, and the final efficiency in comparison with the application of the catalyst in as suspended particles is much lower. So now we are going to be faster because we are late, a little bit late. But I want to show you some results and examples of the application of solar photochemical processes for water disinfection. One of the most investigated to now is the combination of hydrogen peroxide with natural sunlight. There is a small history about the discovery of this combination for water disinfection, because remember that under natural sunlight, the hydrogen peroxide is not generate hydroxyl radicals. However, the first experience demonstrate that this process is highly efficient for the inactivation of microorganisms. In this figure, you can see the profiles of inactivation of spores of a fungi, Fusarium solani. Only with this is the profile of inactivation only with natural sunlight, and the inactivation when we add in different concentration of hydrogen peroxide under natural sunlight. There is many other different papers and studies focusing on investigating this effect, and it has been demonstrated the high efficiency for the inactivation of bacteria, viruses, antibiotic resistant bacteria. We have here the inactivation of Pseudomonas and E. coli, and also the resistant counterparts in urban wastewater. This is the inactivation. This is an example of inactivation of bacteria, viruses, and also sulfate reducing Clostridia spores by the presence of hydrogen peroxide, and all of them demonstrate a very good inactivation performance. The mechanisms proposed for the explanation of this procedure is because a part of the effect of the sunlight on the microorganisms internally speaking, when we add in the hydrogen peroxide, it has the capability to freely diffuse inside the cells, react with some metals such as the iron present naturally in the water, and generate a photophaton reaction inside the microorganisms and generate hydroxyl radicals that will damage different parts of the microorganisms, and finally it will to be death, and it's a very efficient process. We have also investigated the use of persulfate and peroxymonosulfate for water and wastewater disinfection, and also it has demonstrated that under certain conditions it can be efficiently inactivate microorganisms. Why the inactivation mechanism is efficient also with persulfate or peroxymonosulfate? Basically, in this case, the main way is the direct membrane oxidation by the presence of both oxidative agents, like you can see here. This is the main way, but also both agents could, under certain circumstances, diffuse inside the microorganisms and also generate a reaction that can generate other type of hydroxyl radicals and sulfate radicals inside the microorganisms that finally determine the inactivation. So after that, there is the other parameters that we have speaking in some moments during the presentation, but don't forget that to evaluate efficiently our solar water disinfection processes, there is a parameter that you must take into account. One of them, or the first, is the type of microorganisms. Remember that the resistance is different, and the bacteria are the group of less resistant, while cysts of protozoa are the higher resistant. The type of treatment, there are low oxidative or high oxidative processes, also depending on the concentration of the agents or the catalyst that we are used. When we consider the application of solar radiation, the intensity is very important because it's changed along the day. The water temperature, because for water disinfection is very important, it has a benefit on the inactivation, especially at temperatures higher than 30 or 35 degrees, where it could start some synergies that benefit the inactivation. The turbidity is very important when we speak about the solar processes that can be driven by solar photons, because it can reduce the processes, and also it can act like a screen protecting the microorganisms from the action of these solar photons. The chemical composition of the water is, of course, important. If we have organic matter, it could act like a competition for the radicals generated, and the inorganic species, especially if we consider the presence of carbonates and bicarbonates, because they are very efficient scavenger of the hydroxyl radicals generated in the process. The pH of the water, I mean, also is important to have considered because acid pH strongly affects the viability of bacteria. Post-treatment is another important parameter that could be considered, especially from the point of view of the potential regrowth of viable but non-cultivable bacteria and the presence of residual chemical concentration. And also investigate the toxicity, as Isabel explained you in a previous webinar. And the presence of other pollutants are also very important to consider, because the microcontaminants should be degraded to have a safety reuse of wastewater, and also the new target related to the presence or spreading of antibiotic-resistant bacteria, which are the genes. So finally, just some concluding remarks about all this area of research is that the microbial contamination of the currently available water resources requires the application of efficient disinfection treatments. Depending on the final use and the origin of the fresh water intended to be used for any human activity, the quality of the water and the requirements are different. The regulation are focused on the minimum requirement and need to avoid important and direct risks for human and environment. Nevertheless, from the research point of view, other parameters than the strictly included on those legislation should be analyzed and monitored. And specifically in for wastewater reclamation, the elimination of the antibiotic-resistant bacteria genes and antibiotics must be considered, as well as the microbial regrowth after the treatment. And finally, there are a number of different water disinfection processes, but none of them are the unique solution for all water problems. In general, the advanced oxidation processes have high efficiency in the control of bacteria and also antibiotic-resistant bacteria, but there are less information about the capability and the optimization processes for the elimination of antibiotic-resistant one, and it needs more research. And finally, this is, from my point of view, very important, that to obtain a very good and efficient treatment, from my point of view, the most important thing is to think in the combination of different processes in a sequential way to obtain a good performance and also try to reduce the cost of the treatment, because this is also an important point for implementation. So that's all. Thank you very much for your attention. And this is a very recent picture of the solar water treatment group.
So that's it. Thank you very much, Inma. Highly interesting and a lot of information for a few times. So thank you very much for your presentation. I'm allowing.
I'm going to stop to share, Lisa.
Yeah, no problem. Stop. We have two questions in the chat. However, I have allowed also people to unmute themselves after these two questions, just in case. We are over time, but at least let Inma to answer these two questions. The first one is from Cesar Pulgarin. He asks, why did you treat the antibiotic-resistant bacteria and genes as a special case if they have demonstrated not to be more resistant to AOPs or other oxidation methods than normal bacteria and genes?
Yeah, because we investigated at the beginning. I speak several years ago, like in special cases, but then we start to see that the resistance to the processes are different. But now the important is not so important the antibiotic resistant bacteria as a microorganism. The important is the capability of the process to degrade the antibiotic resistant genes that those bacteria contains inside. So for this, when we did treat and investigate wastewater where we have the pool of antibiotics, bacteria, antibiotic-resistant bacteria, and this is important to follow and monitor what happened and what the efficiency of the process in the full spectrum of the targets. Also considering that for regulation, this type of bacteria and genes are not included. So from the point of view of regulation, the application of a treatment should be only have the capability of reduce bacteria, viruses, and protozoa.
Okay. Then Stefano Alberti asks you, how can we calculate the amount of titanium dioxide required to disinfect water, distinguishing from free suspended titanium dioxide unsupported attend exactly. So I suppose he wants to know how to calculate the concentration of titanium dioxide. Just if you
when you work with suspended titanium dioxide, the concentration that you use is the concentration that you weigh, and then you add. The optimization is based on the type of water you have and the path length of the solar photons in the system. We know that when the application of compound parabolic collector that are the system that has the mirror that potential the collection of photons, the amount of catalyst that can be used could be higher or lower depending on the diameter, but it's more effective that if you don't use the mirror. So the amount of titanium dioxide you cannot calculate previously. You must consider what type of system you have, what is your target, what is your type of water, because it could be different. Mm-hmm. And in comparison with the suspended TO2, the ways to immobilize the titanium dioxide or other catalysts in supports are different. So the people that the research focus on that normally use different amount of catalysts and test different ways of supporting. Of supporting titanium or titanium dioxide, and if I'm not wrong, because I'm not an expert on development of immobilization or catalyst, with a scanning microscope and XPR analysis, Raman analysis, I think all these type of system are used to measure the concentration of titanium dioxide over substrate.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, I was going to tell, please, you can unmute yourself if you want to ask.
Thank Excuse you, me, Ima.
Yeah.
You,
hello, Tessa.
Hello. Do you really think that heterogeneous photocatalysis could really be a good option for water disinfection, taking in account the toxicity, potential toxicity of this material, and also the enormous difficulty to support in a good way? We were involved also with Plataforma Solar in two European projects about that, and we never obtained a good supporting material for disinfection. And then I don't understand why you and other people continues to work in this field, really. I excuse me for this direct and honest question.
No, thank you, Tessa. In fact, I agree with you with the fact that the comparing the efficiency of semiconductors with homogeneous system. The efficiency is higher in the homogeneous system or the photochemical processes.
The toxicity and fixation support problems, what do you are going to overpass these difficulties?
Yeah, the difficulties is that the efficiency is quite lower. This is the system that has the lowest efficiency for water disinfection, and especially for complex processes. The continuously working in this area is because the supporting, this is the theory, because the supporting of material avoid the need to retry the catalyst after the treatment. Which in the case of titanium dioxide, one of the most normal way is the sedimentation. But or you permit the sedimentation, or you retire the catalyst with filtration. It's the only way to avoid to separate the catalyst from the water after the treatment. So the immobilization, in theory, avoid this problem, but it's true that there is other factors that make this this application not so attractive right now. But maybe it's still for discovering the new immobilization system that can be scaled up in a very good or good efficiency.
Thank you.
I here we have a comment. Well, first, Rafael Correa say very interesting webinar. Thank you. And there is a comment from Manuel Figueredo. I think it's clearly in line with your answer, Inma, to the first question of Cesar. And this is something that you have said a lot of times as a biologist. And he's commenting, he says, Manuel says, I have a comment about the Cesar Pulgarin question. Maybe some biologist, in this case, Inma is biologist, so she can answer. In the room can correct me. Bacteria usually has asexual reproductions, which means that they are clones of their parents, but they can obtain new genes through plasmid incorporation with other bacteria or even from the medium. So if you inactivate the bacteria, but the antibiotic resistant gene is still in water, and other bacteria can obtain and use these genes.
Exactly. Totally correct, Manuel. In the wastewater, you have a mix of bacteria or antibiotics and these genes that after several mutations could give the capability of bacteria to be resistant in the presence of this antibiotic. When a bacteria acquired this capability spontaneously or by a different mutation in the DNA, it can be transferred vertically or horizontally, depending on the strain. This capability by transferring directly the DNA or just only by the continuous reproduction of bacteria in the water. So for this it's very important to start to focus on the antibiotic resistant genes that that can be present in the wastewater. So you are totally correct.
And Rafael Correa asks, how do you take off the suspended titanium dioxide after treatment?
Yeah, the most simple way is sedimentation, but the sedimentation is a process that need an additional step that should be by filtration. It's the only way to have sure that you have not any nanoparticles in the water that can generate further risk or toxicity.
Well, Manuel says again, thank you, Inma, beautiful webinar.
Thank you, Manuel.
I think there's no more questions, but if someone wants to say something, you can unmute yourself if you want. You are allowed. Luigi also said thanks, Inma, for the really interesting webinar, and thank you. It's a pleasure for us.
Thank you.
Yeah, because he said thank you, Isa, for the support, but it has been any support almost. So.
Of course.
from Asian, she said very comprehensive meeting. Alex Cubareja said thank you for an insightful presentation. Yeah, thank you very much for sharing your expertise and for these insightful questions.
Just to say that in some moment you have any question, just you can find us at the PSA.
Yeah, you can go to PSA webpage.
Exactly.
We are there. You can contact Inma, of course. But I think it's 3:22, so I think we are quite late. So thank you very much, Inma, for your kind presentation, for your explanations and your deep insight on the bacteria world and genes, which is quite interesting. And so thank you very much for attending to the rest of people. We have attained 69 attendees at the end, so it's highly successful. So thank you very much. And remember next webinar is going to be next month by Professor José Antonio Sánchez Pérez about solar photoreactors design. So it's going to be quite interesting also. So thank you very much to all of you.
Thank you.
Hope to see you all in person next year in some summer school. So bye. Thank you very much to all of you. Bye.